I know we've had a lot of questions surrounding some of the files we provide students, like the engine and the resources. So all the work that students will be doing will be in the app.js file, which is has tons of comments in it. So make sure you read through that file first before you even start. Mike put in sort of comments that sort of guide you through what you have to build. If you haven't had a chance to look at it, I mean, it just kind of gives you the basic structure for a few things, and then you just have to sort of flesh out the rest of it.
Yep. Mm-hmm. We'll start with the engine.js. Okay. So, as I mentioned, a game is really just a flip book. It's the process of drawing images on top of each other over and over and over, and it provides the optical illusion of animation. So we created this engine.js file because we haven't taught you anything about the canvas tag yet, really, at this point. But we do have the HTML5 canvas course, which is awesome. So
I went through that one last night. It's a lot of fun.
It is a lot of fun. It's really cool.
Cameron and James did a really good job putting that course together. So, again, if you haven't had a chance to look at the HTML5 canvas course and you're interested in that kind of stuff, it's a really fun short course. I think it's 2 lessons.
Yeah.
It took me like an hour and a half to get through.
Yeah, and it's a lot of fun. It'll teach you a lot of what's going on in this engine.js file. But that's the reason this file exists, is because for the purposes of object-oriented JavaScript, we don't really want you to worry about what's going on the canvas. So this file creates a canvas element for you and puts it on the screen. It then sets up what we call a game loop. Your typical game loop has a render function, which will render everything on the screen based off of various data points. And then it'll have an update function, which serves as updating those data points.
It's like flipping the page in our book.
Exactly. So let's take your player character, for instance. When you first start the game up, your player character should have like an X and Y position of where it's at and a sprite that tells you what image to load. Anytime you press the up key, we listen for that event. And then in your player's update function, you should say, okay, if the up key is pressed, I need to decrease my X value on that player from this to this. The update function only updates that property. It's the render function that later on says, okay, now redraw everything. And by the process of that X property being different, now your character is drawn in a different location. In the main function, you see we're kind of playing around with dates and times a little bit. The reason we do that is to provide the opportunity for smooth animation. So everyone's computer, like I don't know what kind of computer you have, and you know if you run this on a MacBook Pro or a MacBook Air, your computer can process animation faster than mine, potentially, or slower. And so what that means is on your computer for every tick, and a tick is the game loop. Each time it loops, we call that a tick. So it updates and renders, and that's a tick. If you're on a really good computer, your ticks will be going really, really fast.
Yeah.
And my ticks on a slower computer might not be going that quick. And the way that plays itself out is your bugs are screaming across the screen really quick, and mine are cruising along a little slower. So we need a constant to smooth this out and make sure that my ticks and your ticks generate a same pace for these animations. Thankfully, time is a pretty good constant. So anytime you have smooth animation, you want to multiply that animation against the difference of the time that the last tick ran and the current tick. And that's what creates the smooth animation for your bugs. That way your bugs run just as quickly as mine do.
And the variable we've defined that as is the DT variable.
The engine function also draws what we call the level. And so that's the base layer. If you think of kind of layering a cake, you know, the level we draw first, and then we draw all our characters because they're transparent PNGs, so we can draw them without affecting things. So we also take care of drawing the level for you. You can go in and modify this if you want to build up.
Plenty of people have made the board wider, taller, added their own sprites, and things like that. It's pretty easy. If you want to modify it, you pretty much just add a new item into the array, new image into the array, and then either increase or decrease the number of rows and columns based on how big you want it.
Yep, and we have all the code there to handle loading up your images. So I guess we'll look at resources.js. This is just an easy image loader for you. So loading an image in JavaScript can kind of be an intense process. Like you have to create a new image, and then you have to apply a source attribute to it. And if you want any events to happen when that image loads, and you have to do things in a different order, it can get messy. So yeah. All this does is it handles all of that for you. So you have a really nice helper function called resources.get, and anytime you call that with passing in a URL, it'll go grab that URL for you and load it up as an image you can use in your canvas. One of the other benefits of this is that we have a caching layer, like a really simple cache built in. So if you call resources.get an image 100 times, it's only going to go build that image one time because it knows it already has it. So it just helps in memory and performance.
I'm going to show you guys the app.js, which is very important, which is what you will be working with. As you can see, we have already provided you with an enemy class. So in JavaScript, a class object or a function is going to look the same and is going to be defined the same way. So when you see variable enemy equals function, this is actually an enemy class, and they have given this.sprite. So sprite is actually a keyword for representing images. So it's going to give you the image of the enemy. And then right here, you have the update function for the enemies as well as the render function for the enemy. So these are going to be the member functions of the enemy class. And as you can see, the update function takes in DT. So the DT parameter is to be multiplied with the movement of the bug for smooth transition. That is why we are doing it. And it's going to be the same on all browsers, on all sort of operating systems. So you don't need to worry about it. And that's why we use the delta parameter. Render is, again, going to render the bug. And then what you're going to do is add in the player class, very similar to the enemy class. Only that you should add in an additional functionality in your player class, which is called check collisions, because every time a bug and a player collide, you need to reset the game. So that is why you are going to be using the check collisions function. Finally, at the end, as you can see, we have a number of keys specified, left, right, up, and down. So these keys are going to be an event listener. So anytime you hold down any of these keys, the left, right, up, or down arrows, you need to call an handle input method that is going to increment or decrement your X and Y values for your player depending on his movements. So left is going to, you know, move the player, left and right are going to move the player along the y-axis, whereas up and down will move the player along the y-axis. So you need to define another method called handle input that is going to take in, that is going to listen to your keyboard strokes and do the necessary movements. So that's about it with the app.js file. And do look into the rubric. Amanda, do you have any important pointers for our students?
I think the most important thing I've seen students is not taking as much time as they might need to just really look through what's already here. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important to get comfortable with the starter code. Mm-hmm. And then recall that most of your code is going to go into the app.js.
Yeah.
That's like where you're going to do most of your work.